Greetings, legendary listeners. Welcome to the Marvelous TV Club, a podcast tackling our collective obsession with the latest releases from the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And today we are all about the fourth episode of Falcon and the Winter Soldier, titled The Whole World is Watching. Every week, we analyze the latest chapter of the MCU from all sorts of unique angles. On Monday, Christine Kippens and I will bring you our character cast, in which we will judge the decision-making of the major players in this pivotal episode. On Wednesday, Jesse Taylor and our show PonderVision will zoom out to ask the deepest, weirdest, and most enjoyable questions left unanswered as we look ahead to episode 5. But as always, we begin our weekly analysis with this show, Storycast. This is where we break down TV episodes not by plot, but by themes, symbols, genres, and archetypes. This is one of the most unique TV analysis episodes in all of the vast expanse of Podcastlandia, and you can only get it here from the Marvelous TV Club. I am your host, Marc Faletti, and today I am joined by our two story experts from Salon.com, writer Amanda Marcotte. How's it going, Amanda?
Good.
And from Manhattan College, we've got Professor of English, Maeve Adams. How are you, Dr. A?
I'm doing great. You know, it's basically spring. Lots of people I know are vaccinated. Life is good.
Yeah, let's celebrate the things that are worth celebrating. Speaking of that, we are in the top 20 Apple podcast rankings for TV after shows in Ireland and New Zealand.
What?
And wildly, we are number one in TV after shows in Apple podcast rankings in Croatia. So woo-hoo. I'd like to say a hearty book to our Croatian listeners, especially. I never would have guessed that the Marvelous TV Club would be its own sort of united one world government of sorts. But hey, here we are.
Hey, do you guys know that my grandmother is a New Zealander? Was a New Zealander?
Is she listening to the show? I'm assuming not.
I mean you know. from if we believe in heaven, from heaven.
Okay, sure. We're going to get into that in this episode.
So, you know, I'm shout out to my Kiwis because I'm a little Kiwi.
You know, we spend the bulk of this episode in Eastern Europe, and we get a lot of interactions between characters who seem to be wrestling with big, deep philosophical questions. It's almost like they've taken part in our own story cast, except, of course, they couldn't have because they did all this months ago. All I'm saying is this show is wrestling with a lot of big stuff, and so are we, which is why I turn to you, Amanda, to help us understand this episode better. Talk to me about a theme that might be driving the story and the plot and the character development in this episode.
I mean, what was really clear to me was that this episode was really struggling with the concepts of temptation and corruption. The super soldier serum.
Rolls right off the tongue.
Yeah. is this temptation object? I mean, Carly's tempted by it. John's tempted by it. We have many open discussions about if you had a chance to take it, would you? Which I think a lot of us have had similar discussions about the COVID vaccine and if you got in early. But unfortunately, that does not give you superpowers besides the power to like go to a restaurant and eat there. But, you know, I think we'd take it at this point. But, you know, temptation, corruption, that really kind of spoke to me in this episode.
Guys, I would totally take the super serum.
Super soldier
super
serum.
Hero, whatever serum business. Super soldier serum. I think I would take it. I want to be badass strong and be able to, like, do cool shit.
It would be extremely tempting. I can't see a world in which I would honestly turn it down. So the temptation is very real. Amanda, where did you see that cropping up for someone most specifically? I mean, there's obviously one character that kind of jumps to mind, but where do you want to begin with the textual evidence for this idea of temptation and corruption?
So literally we have three characters that are asked directly if they had a chance to take the super soldier serum, if they would, Hoskins, Sam, and John Walker, right? And what's interesting is like Hoskins says without hesitation, yes. Sam says without hesitation, no. Walker never really answers the question, does he? He struggles with it.
Yeah.
And we are made to believe that Carly and the other flag smashers struggled with this question themselves. They struggle with it when they unearth the bag of serum and should we make more super soldiers? So it is the question kind of lingering over the episode. And interestingly, the worthiness of taking it was kind of delineated by how unwilling you were to take it.
Yeah, it's interesting because there are different reasons. The characters aren't all wrestling with the same question about whether they take it.
What questions are they wrestling with?
Well, you know, Carly is wrestling with the question of whether or not it's the right thing to do for the cause, whereas John is wrestling with a question of whether or not, I mean, I think he wrestles probably with a few different questions, but his is more personal, right? It's like, do I want to be?
Yeah, but I mean, I think both of them at the end of the day probably would say that they're taking it for the cause. And in fact, John makes the argument that if we had had this in Afghanistan, that would have gone very differently, right? So yeah. What we see is one character after another telling them the same story that Steve Rogers told himself in the first Avenger, which is, I am taking this for the greater good, right? But what we see is that all of them have actually been corrupted by this temptation. Mm. You know, the symbolism of temptation is really like we're hit kind of over the head of with it. Like literally the bag of candy is thrown into the screen and Baron Zemo says, this is Turkish delight. And he calls it irresistible, right? Mm. And I flagged that because Turkish delight is very famously the candy at the center of the story, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, the kind of the first story in the Chronicles of Narnia, right?
Right.
For those who haven't read those books or it's been a long time since they've read it, basically the kind of role that Turkish delight plays in the narrative is that one of the four children in the book, Edmund, goes into Narnia by himself and he meets the White Witch, who is this kind of evil but seductive character, and she gives him Turkish delight. So it's like when Persephone goes to hell in Greek mythology and she has to eat the fruit. The whole idea is that by consuming that there's a physical object that is temptation and then you're corrupted by eating it. And Edmund eats a Turkish delight, becomes kind of enslaved to the White Witch. He believes that he's going to be the prince and he has to be saved by the lion Aslan sacrificing his life in order to free Edmund from the witch's grip.
Huh.
Turkish delight is very famous in this book, and we get multiple mentions of it, and Baron Zemo's waggling it around like he's the White Witch in the Narnia Chronicles.
Well, he certainly gives it to actual children. Can I ask a simple question? What does Turkish delight taste like?
I mean, it's like a fluffy kind of candy, right?
Looked more like a Jolly Rancher.
It looked like a Jolly Rancher, but the Turkish delight I've had has always been kind of like jelly, like a kind of like... Not like Jell-O. It's not that soft. It's a harder jellied candy. Hmm. I'm not myself an enormous fan of it. I don't love the texture. But yeah, it's famous, right? From a literary perspective.
Yeah, if you read The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe as a kid and you've never eaten Turkish delight, as I had not when I was a kid, it sounded like the most delicious thing in the world.
Wait, you know, fun fact. You mentioned Persephone. So... Persephone has to eat a pomegranate, right?
Mm-hmm.
And there's some reason to believe that the apple in the Garden of Eden was actually a pomegranate, not the kind of apples that we
eat.
Like a
granny red or whatever they call it.
Like, yeah, exactly. The way that it's pictured in like Renaissance paintings. It's like, this is a big red apple. It's like, the Garden of Eden was supposedly in the Middle East, like. I don't know. Are apples cultivated in the Middle East? I'm not sure.
No, I mean, that's obviously Europeanizing.
Yeah.
the story, which was probably Babylonian and probably borrowed a lot from the Greek myth. And, you know, now that you say that, I think it is worth pointing out, obviously, that the Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, if it's not really obvious, is a very on-the-nose Christian fable.
Yeah, seriously.
I mean, Aslan is Christ. Edmund is the sinner who needs to be saved. The White Witch is Satan offering the poisoned fruit that corrupts somebody. And Aslan has to sacrifice himself in order to save the sinner. So he's a very Jesus figure. And it's worth pointing out that so is Steve Rogers.
Wait, are you saying Steve Rogers is the Christ figure of this story?
Yes. So Steve Rogers is, like Jesus Christ, a pure being who is without sin, which is why he can take the super soldier serum and not be...
Possibly a virgin.
Yeah, no. And not be corrupted by it.
He's not a virgin, but, you know, it's on the table.
Not that it matters.
Well, you know, Jesus was, right? Unless you're like a Dan Brown enthusiast.
I am not. Yeah, but it's funny though, because, you know, it's if Steve Rogers is a kind of Christ figure, he's as we were discussing in the last episode of the podcast, he's not a perfect Christ figure.
But he's about as close as you get. But I mean, he has the Christ arc.
How so?
He, you know, is an ordinary man who becomes a god, right? Mm. Functionally. Okay. He sacrifices himself to save the world.
True.
He rises again.
Holy shit. Oh, and he ascends to heaven with Peggy at the end of his story.
Wait, but Bucky also basically rises again.
That's true. But yeah. He doesn't really sacrifice his life. He just gets killed because Steve wanted his buddy with him while he was hunting Nazis.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, and Steve kind of, and just like in kind of like, I think this episode is definitely wrestling with a lot of these questions because there's discussion between Sam and Baron Zemo about like what makes somebody a god, what makes somebody kind of worthy of being, assigning themselves these kinds of powers. And it's like the answer is everybody in this story is too fallen. They have, or are they, right? Most of the people in this story are too flawed to assume the kind of power that Steve was able to wield with honor. And the only reason is that Steve is almost a perfect figure, at least in the first Avenger. Mm. Baron Zemo sees Steve as a flawed, sinful person who exploited his power. If you've watched all the movies, you see Steve really kind of at least walk up to the line many times.
Yeah. I mean, it's funny because temptation stories are often about, you know, fallenness, right? The idea that humans are innately flawed morally, but also about their humanness, that there's something fundamentally human about the way that we succumb to temptation and the way that temptation leads to some kind of downfall of one or another. And there are lots of stories that are resonant in that context. And stories that, you know, have a bare relationship to the Garden of Eden story. But I think it's striking that, you know, it's true too here that everybody, Carly included, especially maybe in this episode, is a figure who's given in to temptation because she is human, but her humanity is very, very, her humanness is represented in really fundamentally different ways from the quote unquote humanness of somebody like John or the humanness of Sam. Sam and Carly are really allied in this episode, or Sam gets Carly. Carly's willing to talk to Sam because they kind of fundamentally understand something about each other's humanness and the things that they are willing to do to get the good things that they want or the things that they think are good.
But Carly and John are also aligned, right? Which is,
yeah,
they are both people that think they're right, and they think that therefore they're entitled to use the super soldier serum as a way to get their way through force, right? So functionally, both of them fall for the same temptation. Both of them are corrupted in exactly the same way. Both of them kill people.
Mm.
You know, that look of horror on her face at the end when she's watching John Walker beat somebody to death with the shield, her friend. I mean, there's a lot of ways to interpret that. One way to interpret it is she sees herself in him.
Well, because she's just done that, right? Or, you know, she's just accidentally killed Lamar. And the same, she has the same look on her face in those two scenes that are back to back, which I think is really striking. I also think it's amazing that in a superhero show, everything stops all of a sudden when somebody dies. Has that literally ever happened, ever in the history of superhero shows? Has a fight where somebody dies just come to a screeching halt and everyone's like, you know, detente, basically?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, they filmed that obviously to be very reminiscent of cop violence in America with you know, people surrounding it in phones and stuff. And I do think they certainly want us to sit with that. But you're right. I don't recall another superhero show or another superhero movie where they really pause to reflect on that violence.
So, like, setting aside like the whole Steve Rogers is Jesus, because I think that's really there to kind of be a counterpoint to all these people who are very, you know, human. Like, they're all comparing themselves to this person that literally is a unique individual for which no other person is quite like him, right?
Mm.
The kind of arc of like temptation, corruption, that's literally one of the most famous kinds of stories in all of literature. I mean, Macbeth is that story. Citizen Kane is that story. Daenerys in Game of Thrones is that story.
Yeah.
It's all these people are the same story over and over again. Somebody who says, I deserve power because I'm the person who can wield it correctly. And Steve makes that same argument. And right. This show, I think, is trying to sort of posit, like, how would you know?
Right, because almost everybody thinks that they're capable of being the best version of themselves with that super soldier serum in their hands. So we've talked about Walker being tempted. We've talked about Carly being tempted and the corruption that caused both of them. What plays the role of the item of temptation then? Is it the super soldier serum?
Yeah, it's the super soldier serum.
Got it.
I mean, the super soldier serum is very much like the fruit from the tree of knowledge in Genesis, right? It is the whole point of that story is that Adam and Eve are just humans, and Satan tells them, if you eat this fruit, then you will be like a god.
Yeah.
That you will be God's equal, right?
Right.
And so they eat it to be God's equal. So like the super soldier serum is, you eat this and you will be the equivalent of Steve Rogers, who is playing a godlike role in this story, at least in this episode.
So then that makes me want to ask some questions about Zemo, because if the super soldier serum is the fruit of the tree of knowledge, how does he fit into this narrative, I guess?
I mean, he's very explicitly like laid out as a kind of Satan character in a lot of ways, because he's like the white witch handing out Turkish delight to innocent children, right? So that's underscored. But yeah, I mean, I would say that Baron Zemo is very much aligned with Satan in this kind of story, or Prometheus in sort of the Greek version, right? They're all characters that argue that it is unfair for gods to put themselves above us, and that humans should be equal to gods. And they make that argument to humans, and then they are punished for it, right? Satan in heaven says he's God's equal. He's cast out of heaven. He makes the same argument again to Adam and Eve. They get punished for it. Prometheus makes that argument to the gods. He gets his liver taken out every day by an eagle.
Terrible.
Okay, but in the Prometheus one, that's such a good example, because Prometheus is like, hey, I'm trying to give fire, the power of the gods, to the people.
Yeah.
Is not the super soldier serum the fire in that example, which makes Zemo kind of the anti-Satan, the anti-Prometheus, because he's trying to take super soldier serum out of the world.
He's got the same ideology as Satan, right? Which is that the goal is equality. The goal is not having gods. It's like, no gods, no heroes, right?
Yeah.
And he's just sort of going about it a different place, which is like tearing the gods down instead of building humans up to be like gods.
Okay. That makes some sense to me.
He's like a soldier of like redistributive justice or something. Milton's Paradise Lost, which, you know, retells the story. Paradise is literally lost, right? So Garden of Eden story, where Satan says that it is better to reign in hell than to serve in heaven. Right. So, you know, Satan is fundamentally questioning a distribution of power that has disadvantaged him. And so in order to do that, he redistributes power as in the form of knowledge in this case. But you're right, Amanda, like he's not just giving them like an encyclopedia. He's giving them the power of God. That power is something that he thinks should not be in the hands of a single almighty being. I mean, of course, he's also angry, right? Like that's kind of how, I mean, I'm not saying Satan is, you know, that's the way Satan's represented in literature is right. That he's not, he's angry, he's vengeful. But I think there's a way of telling that story that seeks to understand motivation that's more than simply like, I'm just trying to be evil.
Yeah. I mean, I think, This show is a really good example because, I mean, I think a lot of us who've read Paradise Lost have the same reaction, which is Satan is supposed to be the villain, but he feels like the hero a lot of the time. And, you know, obviously the romantics read it that way. But also, I think this episode plays with that, right, too, which is like Carly is a very Satan-like figure in that sense, right? She's making the argument that the super soldier serum needs to be redistributed to people like her because that's the only way to make the world fair. And, you know, kind of like a classic biblical story, she's corrupted by that. But I think it's it's worth taking a moment and really thinking about some of the criticisms of the kind of classic Christian narrative, which is the idea that it was used and repeatedly, like especially through like medieval times, to justify unequal distribution of power, right?
Yeah, and to lay blame at the at the door of women, right?
Yeah,
you know, like the stories about temptation and corruption are blame game stories. Often, not always, but often, right? The Garden of Eden is a blame game story. You know, Satan was a baddie. He took this, you know, he convinced Adam and Eve to do a bad thing. And because of that, they will always be fallen. They are corrupted by mortal sin. And that mortality is a sign and signifier of the fact that they are sinful. But I think, you know, there's a lot of literature that like this episode also at kind of play with that idea of who's really to blame here, right? This episode doesn't allow us to easily kind of assign blame, even though John has basically just turned into a thug with a cute outfit, right?
Like, is that outfit cute? Even that, I think, is
I don't know. I kind of like it. I love the colors. It's so saturated.
Wow. That might be the hottest take in the history of the Marvelous TV Club. Christine is going to flip when she hears
I can't
that.
Wait to hear what she has to say, since she thinks that, like, you know, John is my Captain America, and, you know, I just said he had a cute outfit. I'm looking forward to that.
Her heart was very warmed by you following up on that.
I look forward to being trolled, actually. I like.
Yeah, we'll get you guys on a show together, and I think you're going to
have a lot of fun. That would be awesome. I would love that.
But anyway, we were talking about literature. We were talking about literature that has this.
Right. So the temptation story is a blame game, right, is Lord of the Flies, right?
Yeah. Oh, sure.
Right. So, you know, Lord of the Flies, a bunch of kids are offered the opportunity to rule themselves. And they are all corrupted by that desire for power and the sort of privilege that comes along with it.
Or like Icarus and the story of flying too high to the sun. But I really want to like underscore for people, think about what the moral of these stories can be read as, right? Which is like, don't be ambitious, don't question systems of power, don't seek knowledge, you know, because that's bad and it will corrupt you. I think that's why the Prometheus story has always been kind of a fascinating one, because it's the one myth that I think gets read in a way I think we modern people would rather read these kinds of stories, which is he's the hero, the gods are the bad guys.
Yeah, they're the big meanies.
Yeah. Well, and I would say like every character in this story, in this episode, understands that Zemo is right on some level. Like they all believe that it is that the intolerable situation is a handful of very powerful people have the super soldier serum.
Well, we've talked about John Walker and his serum temptations and Carly and her serum temptations. We've talked about Steve Rogers as the Christ-like figure looming over all of this, and Zemo as possibly a kind of Satan who's doing a reverse Prometheus to try to level the playing field between the gods and the mortals. But we haven't really fit our two main characters into this. Where do Bucky and or Sam fit into the temptation and corruption storyline?
Well, Sam is interesting to me because he's the character that, when asked if he would take the super soldier serum, said without missing a beat, no.
And he also is the person who tries to take the nonviolent out as much as possible, which is very Christ-like. Are they positioning him as the closest to Steve Rogers?
Yeah. To bring it back to Narnia, there's this whole thing in the book where Aslan really has the power to decide who the kings and queens of Narnia are, right? And he chooses the children at the end of the story. And Steve Rogers chose Sam, which we've heard over and over and over again.
And what about Bucky?
I mean, Bucky is obviously the redemption story, right? He's there to figure that he's literally taken the serum.
Yeah.
And was corrupted by it. And the question is, can he was redeemed by Steve Rogers.
Oh boy.
Well, and the Wakandans, right? Like his redemption is in part because the Wakandans take him through this, that sort of ritual of deprogramming.
I mean, say more. It's about that, Maeve, because it's interesting to me. What role do you think the Wakandans play in terms of these kind of narratives about power? Because they are powerful people.
Yeah, and you know what's funny about the Wakandans is that they're a fundamentally pretty feudal society, right? And so, you know, it's striking that we haven't talked much about the Wakanda. I mean, part of it is they're not really in this. They haven't been in very many episodes. They only just arrived in the last episode. But they're tricky in the context of the stuff we've been talking about in terms of modernity and democracy and, you know, all these sort of things that we value and that many of the characters that we like value, because they're not a fundamentally democratic society. They're a monarchy.
I mean, the implication in the story, I think, is that because they've never wanted for anything, they've never evolved politically.
That's really fascinating.
They've never had enough conflict in their society to, like, why would a democracy develop in a society where no one wants for anything and so there's no tussling for resources?
I mean, historians of democracy would argue that there's a reason that societies bend towards democracy, and it has to do in part with access to resources, right? Yeah. Trying to distribute resources in an equitable way, or in a way that doesn't have a bunch of people dying on your hands, right? Like, in creating a public health problem. But yeah, I think that's right about the Wakandans. But, you know, your question was different about that, the role that they're playing here.
Well, one thing I can say about them is that they are also kind of a Promethean story, in that what if Prometheus was successful to the point where everybody, if vibranium is the fire for the Wakandans, then that all ties in everything you were just talking about with the politics of Wakanda are different than what we expect because they haven't wanted, because they were so ultimately successful in utterly leveling the playing field from top to bottom in their society. And so they just sort of stand outside of the struggles of the rest of the world in this blip slash snap scenario where everybody's been displaced and stuff, though we don't know. Maybe there are a bunch of displaced Wakandans. I suspect if anybody solved the problem, though, it's them.
I mean, they come into the story and they do all this violence, and yet none of the discourse around power and violence and diplomacy and any of that touches them. No. They simply are not part of that conversation. Their violence is not treated the same as different other violence. They're not a part of that discourse.
Yeah, well, they're also, I mean, you know, to go back to your point, right, that they've never wanted for anything. If you don't want for anything, how does temptation touch you? You know, this is kind of fundamentally the argument that Karl Marx makes about...
Not me. It wasn't my argument.
It was Mark here making an argument on alienation and socialism and the...
As I want to do. You know, when I do go on sometimes.
You want to just dive into Marxist or...
See?
discourse. But the argument that Marx makes about why an equal distribution of resources is powerful is that it frees you to not want anything. And because you don't need anything, right, everything is provided for you, you can do whatever you want that is not, you know, ultimately destructive to the rest of the community. So there's nothing tempting you to grab at more because you have everything that you need.
Right.
There's a kind of there's a freedom that comes. And of course, we also, you know, we see examples of this when, you know, universal basic income experiments work. They work because of that, right? Because, you know, there's no need for greed if you, you know, because essentially temptation stories are also stories about greed and the mortal sin of greed. So, you know, you don't need to feel greedy if you've been given everything that you want and need. And there's no structure in place socially for you to have more than everybody else.
Yeah. I mean, that's Carly's argument, right? Which is like the super soldier serum stands in for her, for all the other resources that the powers that be are hoarding.
Yeah. Under the guise, ruse of an idea of redistribution, because of course that's the underlying principle of the motto. Which is?
It's reset, restore, rebuild, right?
That's it, yeah.
I mean, literally when Sam talks about the world that Carly remembers, is he not talking about kind of a Marxist paradise?
a utopia, right? Like there's this like, yeah, this kind of, you're exactly right, right? It's this universe in which there weren't national borders. And, you know, basically they say, you know, we all kind of pitched in to help one another.
But more importantly, in part because they didn't lack for resources. This was literally Thanos's argument that he could bring world peace by simply cutting the number of people vying for resources in half, then everybody would have everything they wanted, right? And Carly's making the argument that that Thanos was right. And she knows because you could literally, it's very clear the way they're kind of shaping out the post-snap world is if you were like a renter or you didn't have a great house, now, ta-da, you own a mansion.
Yeah.
A very tempting idea, but yeah, a lot of death.
I think we're getting to your theme, Maeve.
Yeah, let's do it. Maeve, you also picked out a theme that is somewhat related, but I think also stands entirely in its own space. What do you have for us?
The whole show is interested in this problem, but this particular episode really drove this home, that inequality comes with consequences, right? There are consequences, there are perils of inequality. And so, you know, there are several examples of this throughout the episode. The place that I sort of really lit upon this is when Zemo says to Sam and Bucky, the desire to be a superhuman cannot be separated from supremacist traits.
Right.
Right. And of course, this is a universe in which some people can be extremely, extremely powerful and other people have to kind of, you know, just give in to this idea that some people are going to have more power than they do. And Carly, of course, and the Flag Smashers are committed to an idea of redistribution, as we've been talking about, because this world is fundamentally unequal. One of the things that fascinates me about what Zemo says is that he says that, right? And so he seems to be representing an idea that inequality is destructive. Right. But I'm not sure he actually isn't really committed to inequality fundamentally.
Yeah. You're reading my mind, Maeve. You're reading my mind here because Zemo sure seemed fine with inequality for his entire super wealthy life until the moment super soldiers arrived. And suddenly wealth was no longer the most important power in the world. Superhuman abilities became the most sought after, you know, the Bitcoin of the Marvel Universe or whatever. It's like, it's the new thing and everybody wants it and it's worth more and it's more powerful than all the wealth in the world for some of these people. So yeah, my read is maybe he's not so much fighting inequality as trying to go back to the old forms of inequality where he's on top, which is something I talked a little bit about in some of our episodes last week. I don't know. That's where I'm at with this guy.
I mean, be that as it may, he is still the most articulate character when it comes to explaining his philosophy, possibly because he's super rich and got very well educated.
Well, and he leaves out the point about what the systems of inequality look like when we get rid of super soldiers, right? He's just talking about getting rid of one of these things. He's not talking about like, well, then let's get rid of money, or he's not even letting anybody, nobody's thinking about money when he's talking.
No, exactly. I mean, like, you know, he's the one who has all the candy. He's the one who has the big jet, right? He's the one who has the money to give to the girl.
Yeah.
The bribery narrative that repeats itself in the episode is a narrative that relies on inequality to operate. She needs to have not enough money to be able to betray her community. She betrays her community because he's going to hand her, you know, what I can't tell what it's supposed to be. You know, we don't know. It's very loud music here in Bushwick, and I am very sorry about that, friends. But
hey, welcome to the podcast. No, it's good.
I know.
And speaking of music, I'm creeped out by him singing that Ba Ba Black Sheep song. What the hell was that about, Maeve?
You know, it's fascinating that he sings that song because it's ironic, right? You know, the Ba Ba Black Sheep is a nursery rhyme that talks about the equal district Ba Ba Black Sheep. You know, do you have wool, something like that? I've got it for these three different people. And so there are a couple of actually different versions of that nursery rhyme. And the first one is that each of the three figures who are supposed to get wool in the nursery rhyme from the black sheep, each of those figures gets the wool because it's being equally distributed in this world. And that's what makes people happy, is equal distribution of resources and sharing of resources. there's another version of it where the little boy who cries doesn't get any wool because theoretically, because he's a crybaby or something, or he's like loud and annoying. And so his parents, I don't know, like he gets punished by not getting, you know, the things he needs to keep himself warm. You know, yeah. So it's bizarre that he sings that song.
I want to be the devil's advocate for a little bit. So Zemo.
Please do.
Yeah. Obviously, he's a baron and he's faded aristocrat and he gets around the world using his power and privilege. It seems to me that he is also very self-aware and possibly understands the kind of power that superheroes have precisely because he understands power. Precisely because he knows what it buys you. And he sees superpowers as kind of making, like, he's like, money is bad. I know because I got it.
I haven't heard him say that, but keep going.
But imagine, imagine the inequalities that superheroes cause, right? And I mean, he's just so articulate in explaining these things. He keeps putting Bucky and Sam on their back feet. Like when he was like, you know, Nazis, Avengers, as if they were the same thing.
Same.
And they were like, that's not fair. And then at the end, we see the Captain America shield covered with blood. And we have to ask ourselves, aren't they though?
Yeah, but you know, the response when, you know, he says super soldiers can't be allowed to exist. And the response is, isn't that how gods talk? Ooh. I mean, that's so persuasive, right? Yeah. We as an audience can't ignore that. First of all, it's a nice beat in the dialogue, right? There's a pause there. We get to take that in because he's fine with inequality as long as it's serving him.
Yeah, you're right, Maeve. That line is a real damning one. And it's, you know, meant to convey, I think, exactly that Zemo was the one who decides because... It's cannot be allowed to exist is his position. He is the arbiter of what is and isn't allowed. And that's, you know, not the most democratic, egalitarian kind of a vibe I've ever felt.
Which is funny because Sam agrees with him, right? True. Sam, when asked if he would take the serum, said no. I think he speaks volumes there, right?
Yeah.
But you were asking what role Sam plays in this narrative, and Sam is the quiet advocate for democracy is the answer to a lot of these questions, okay. Right? He, for instance, gets in this debate with John Walker about how to deal with Carly, and John Walker's like, you know, just beat her up, force her to do what you want, right? And Sam's like, or we sit down... We talk about what everybody wants. Everybody gets heard. Everybody's needs get heard. And we come to some kind of mutual decision about what's best. And, you know, what's funny is once again, Sam is Uncle Sam. Sam is the ideal of America. And he just doesn't even see it because American ideals have been so corrupted.
Wow.
Yeah. And there's a whole philosophy of exactly what you're talking about. That so Jürgen Habermas, this German philosopher, has a theory of what he calls discourse ethics. And what he says is that at the core of democracy is an idea that we sit around, and we've talked about this on this podcast before a little bit, that we sit around and we talk to one another about how ethics are going to serve the entire community. And I think what's interesting about what happens in this episode is that we have a sort of division between those who are sort of committed to some kind of inequality that serves them, like Zemo, like John, right? And then on the other hand, we have people who are committed to more democratic principles of a kind of cooperative understanding of how we serve one another. And that conversation between Sam and Carly is that to a T.
Yeah.
Right. He's trying to also help her understand why her way of doing things so far is fucked up. Right. Like he says, it's not a better world if you're just killing people. It's just different.
Yeah. Right? I mean, their discussion, it struck me as like the discourse between kind of like a gung-ho but half-formed leftist and somebody who's a little bit more mature in their political philosophy because... Yeah, she has this rough sense of equality, but she, again, thinks that the way to achieve it is to force it on people against their will and not sit down and listen to people.
I want to modify that slightly, because I think what Carly says is that nobody, and she's said this in this episode and she said it before, is that nobody is listening to them.
Hmm. Yeah.
Right. So what do you do? And she's not wrong, right? Like, what, I mean, the Black Lives Matter movement, right, is an expression of this in modern America. What do you do when no one's listening and you say it over and over and over again? At some point, it's time to take to the streets.
Though, yeah. You know, Black Lives Matter doing it in a nonviolent way versus Carly exactly. in a violent way, I think does make Sam's point as well.
Yes, no, you're exactly right. And I want to be very clear that I am not conflating those two.
For sure.
That Carly's revolutionary ideology is fundamentally different. But you know, we know what happens when communities are not heard.
Yeah.
And those things are understandable. And Sam really understands that. He also understands that there's something really utopian, but maybe not impossibly utopian, about the idea of, as he says, the whole world working together. Right.
He says straight up to her, "I agree with you, and I hear you, and I see your point of view."
Yeah.
But I mean, she is saying things that, if you piece them out, are a little bit troubling, right?
Mm, yeah.
So, okay, imagine, let's just put yourself in the position of what, and I think we should really think about this. So you were snapped, right? And your house empty. And then you're blipped back, and this family has moved into your house. And now they're saying that it's their house and they have more rights to it than you. I mean, at the end of the day, how do we answer that question?
Somebody gets screwed. There's no way around it. One person gets screwed or another person gets screwed. And you pointed out last week, right, Amanda, the prodigal son story is why people were more sympathetic to people we lost and then got back than the people who were already here. But somebody was always going to get fucked when both people have a totally legitimate claim to half the houses in the world.
Yeah, I mean, if, you know, possession is 9/10 of the law, then, you know, we've got a problem. And, you know, obviously they're in a situation like this, there would have to be systems for trying to figure out how to, again, redistribute. And obviously there's an attempt at that, but the attempt, you know, we hear that from the guy who's like a school teacher or something, you know, they're like, "You're a refugee." And he's like, "No, because, you know, that's what we're called, but that's not who we are. And nobody is actually trying to help rehome us. Like that effort isn't meaningful. Like, we ask for supplies, we ask for resources. We don't get what we need. They say they're sending it." So all of this is basically just talk.
It has a lot of resonance, I think, in our era. But what I think it troubles me a little is, like, and maybe this is actually the point the show is making, is the blipped people or the snapped people and the non-snapped people are being pitted against each other. When my question as a viewer is, are two people that have limited resources being pitted against each other to ignore the fact that there's actually an elite super wealthy that's hoarding all the resources? Because that would actually be the truth of our society.
And Carly makes the same argument here when she points the finger at the corporations, right? It's just that her answer to that has some consequences. So, Maeve, what else about Carly? Was there anything else about Carly's story that jumped out to you as part of this theme of the perils of inequality?
There's another dimension of Carly in this episode that I think help us contemplate what it would mean, what it would mean to try to resolve this problem of inequality. There's that conversation that she has with her friend who dies at the end of the episode in the graveyard, where, and it's a really fascinating framing of the problem, where he says to her, "There were decent people in this world before the blip. I didn't think there could be another Captain America until I met you."
Right.
And it's a thoughtful and distinctive framing from the other framings that we've had of the problem of super soldiers and the super soldier serum, because it's an idea. It's another idea of redistribution, right? What would it mean to redistribute this power? What would it mean to redistribute it to everybody? What would it mean if everybody were a super soldier? The framing of this as a question of decency is one that strikes me, because I think about this a lot around the way that we understand justice in the modern world. largely because of a philosopher whose work I very much like, a philosopher named Avishai Margalit, who wrote a book called The Decent Society. And it's a, I would recommend it to literally everybody. It's a short book. It's extremely accessible. It's a really clearly written book where he says, you know, since classical times, we've been asking questions about what's the good society? You know, what is the just society? What is a fair society? And philosophers have like circled around this problem over and over and over again. And he says, I don't think the problem is what is a good society. The question is, what is a decent society? And what he means by that is a society, as he says, that in which no members of that society are humiliated.
Hmm. Oh, yeah.
Right. And it's actually just a profound framing of this problem. And then he offers these really brilliant examples, right? So prisons that, you know, the prison system that puts people away and deprives people of civil liberties while they're in jail, and then deprives them of civil liberties when they come out of jail. So for example, felons who cannot vote, right, are humiliated members of our community because they're deprived of fundamental things that we say are fundamental to humanity, democratic humanity.
Yeah.
Right. He also makes an argument about gay marriage in a similar way, that so for folks who want to be married and who happen to be gay, it's a way of humiliating those members of that community.
Saying you're less than, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Carly makes almost identically this point in the episode at the funeral, right? She says, yes. I was hungry, I was tired, but the worst part was I was lonely.
Right.
I'm paraphrasing, but like that's a way of saying I was shunned.
And humiliated.
And it was, yeah, it wasn't the food and the clothes that she was given weren't just about meeting physical needs. They were about meeting that deep need to be seen, which is why Sam's instinct to say to her, or to say, like, Sam's instinct is so right. Like, just sitting down and listening to her and giving her the dignity of being heard is good. He was getting super far with her really fast.
You know, there's another totally different example of this. So Carly connects with another character in this episode, and that is Sarah, Sam's sister.
Sure.
Right? And Sarah says, you know, they have this conversation, and Sarah says to her, my world doesn't matter to America, so why should I care about its mascot, right? This is in the context of Carly asking her about Captain America. And I mean, I hadn't thought about it this way at all, Amanda, but I think you're exactly right that the question of decency and humiliation is also a question of being seen as a completely, right, and recognized, and recognizable then to yourself also, right? So Sarah, as a Black woman in America, is representing to us the experience of not mattering to America. So why the hell should I, you know, as she says, sort of commit myself to its ideals and its ideas? I mean, not ideals, but its ideas. It's symbols.
But you are reminded right away that Carly is corrupted, and she knows it because she makes this connection with another human being and then immediately threatens to kill her and her children.
Ugh,
in a way that is, I guess you could say, humiliating, dehumanizing, but just hurtful to Sarah, and definitely dehumanizing.
And you could see Carly's reaction after she hung up, that she knew that and it hurt her to do it.
And she tried to backpedal on it when she sees Sam immediately after. It's like, I would never hurt her. What does she say? I was just trying to, something around trying to drive the point home. But the problem is that, you know, if your means are bad, right, then your ends are bad, right? Like,
That's sort of why Sam, we the viewer, believe Sam is the legitimate Captain America, right? Because he embodies the decency you're speaking about, Maeve. He treats everybody with respect. He treats everybody as a person. He listens to people, and even when he disagrees with them, he disagrees with them not in a condescending way, not in a cruel way. He hears you.
And he says that. He says to Carly, I understand your frustration. I understand your helplessness.
Yeah. But he understands also Baron Zemo.
Totally.
He argues with him a lot in this episode, but he argues with him from a place of respect, which is saying he hears his points, and then when he responds to them, he's legitimately engaging with Zima's points, which is, you can tell that Zima appreciates, even if he gets put on his heels sometime with Sam making a good point.
Well, all this talk about humiliation and the perils of inequality makes me think about John Walker, and I want to throw something out there to see what you guys think about this. I hadn't thought about it till we're talking. One of the perils of inequality is that the people who are sitting at the top of the pyramid also handle slights and humiliations incredibly terribly, which then causes an inappropriate response, an inappropriately violent response. So I think about John Walker here, this white guy who's been sort of the star of everything he's ever been a part of, from his high school football team to his military units and now this Captain America uniform. And when Bucky can just stop him with one hand, it drives him insane. And he's like, you know, it's all really easy for you, isn't it? All that serum running through your veins. It's so humiliating to him in a disproportionate way. Yes, that's modestly humiliating, but Bucky isn't trying to humiliate him. He's trying to let Sam have a conversation. But because John Walker is so privileged, because there are so much inequality in privilege, he's not used to being put in his place. And as a result, things fly off the fucking handle based on stuff like that.
Yeah, I mean, in an fundamentally unequal system, those who have power see any questioning or challenge to their power as humiliation. That's not humiliation. That's, you know, a loss of privilege. That's recognizing that, as it turns out, power is a pie. And if we're going to share it, then you're going to have to take a smaller piece of it if other people are going to have some of it. I mean, I think the other moment that was really striking in this regard is that he's upset about Bucky taking him down. But you know who he's more upset about who? Taking him down? Some black women.
Oh my God. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. I mean,
he's real upset. His ego is so bruised. Ooh.
And he says it's because they're not super soldiers. But let's be honest, the way he reached out and he touched that woman's shoulder and that like patronizing, I mean, every woman who's had a man touch her like that immediately flinched. And that's probably every woman.
Yeah.
Because yeah, exactly. it's a gesture that means so much and is just basically like, settle down, little girl. And you don't treat the Dora Milaje that way.
Nope. And they're going to take you down if you try, which was actually quite sad watching that. That scene was just very satisfying to watch partly for that reason. Because, you know, John's vision of power he really does valorize inequality, but it's fundamentally macho bullshit.
Yeah. Right. He's only measuring himself up against Steve Rogers, right? And
yeah.
And why does he think he gets to be Steve Rogers? Well, because he looks like him.
Yeah. He's American man of the 50s. And that's, you know, he's what that sort of universe saw as worthy of dominating over others.
Notably, that's not what Steve Rogers used to look like, though.
No, he was the kid who was always getting beaten up. He wasn't a thug. He wasn't a football star.
Right.
Remember, right? Like John's a football. He's like a football dude. No aspersions that I am casting upon football as a sport necessarily. But you know, it's a different vision of masculinity. And John's just, you know, fully embodying that kind of macho, domineering, you know, you've got 10 minutes and then we're doing things my way. Okay. All right. Dude.
Look, both of these themes are just rich, rich veins to mine. I want to do a TLDR on both of them to see if I've got them. So let's begin with Amanda's theme. Amanda, please correct my mistakes here. You indicated that this episode was about temptation and corruption. Specifically, John Walker and Carly are facing similar problems around the temptation of the super soldier serum and the way in which they want to sort of take that as a means to achieve their ends, which they believe. So the super soldier serum is what they are tempted by, and chasing it is part of what is corrupting them. Meanwhile, Steve Rogers is kind of like this looming Christ-like figure over the story, right? He's
No, Steve Rogers is definitely the Christ-like figure looming over the story. And I know that a lot of people find religious discussion uncomfortable. I want to add, I am not a Christian. I'm just talking about this story from a purely literary perspective.
Right. No, that's totally right. But like, so Steve Rogers is looming over it because like he has done the thing that Zemo says isn't possible, which is to both have the power, all of this power, and to behave incredibly justly at all times. Yeah. Meanwhile, Zemo is a sort of Satan Prometheus figure who may or may not be trying to level the playing field based on getting rid of the super soldier serum, or is he just making money, the best thing ever again, to be determined. And so this all ties up very closely into The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, precisely because that's a story about these things. There's a character named Edmund who literally takes Turkish delight and becomes corrupted by the promise of being a prince, which is like unto this super soldier serum. And all of that follows all the way through this story. Sam is the closest to Steve in that he is the most Christ-like in this episode, eschewing violence and generally even the temptation of the super soldier serum. Whereas Bucky is the person who has engorged himself on super soldier serum and had a terrible experience and come out the other side as a character redeemed. How does that sound? Am I close? And thank you for the help on the Steve part.
Steve looms over the story like a Christ-like figure, but we have seen Steve get very close. He almost bashed Tony Stark's head in with the shield that one time in a way that's very similar to the way that John Walker bashed that guy's head in this episode. So Baron Zemo's arguments, I think, get more credence than Satan's typically do in the Christian narrative for good reason.
Yeah. Can I just throw in just super fast that if anybody is like, no way is this not, no way is this about sort of Christian references. Guys, all of that stained glass with the crosses in it is a little bit of a gimme to the idea that there are Christian themes running through this. And I, like Amanda, I am also not a religious person. I'm an atheist, but we can read these Christian stories and sort of understand what they're referring to. The evidence is there, my friends.
Yeah, they're appealing for a reason.
Sure.
All right. So let's talk about the second theme then, Maeve. The perils of inequality, in which a bunch of characters are speaking truth about the different kinds of inequality that exist, whether that's Zemo and the potential threat of super soldier serums, Carly and the threat of corporations and the ways in which the repatriation of all these blipped people has disrupted everything. And even Sam and Sarah talking about the very frank realities that they've encountered as Black Americans. Meanwhile, you have John, who sort of represents what happens when people who are at the top of the pyramid get knocked down at the bottom. And all of this is meant to interrogate the question of what it means to have a decent society. And the answers to that are complicated and hard. But I also do think we kind of hit upon it, which is that Wakanda represents maybe the end goal of a society in which, even if we aren't sure that we love their political system, they are a world in which people are finally free from the things that are antagonizing all of these characters.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, I would pull back a little bit from the idea that Wakanda is a kind of ideal that we're moving towards because it's part of, you know, this goes to a little bit what Amanda was saying earlier, that Wakanda is kind of cut off from the world and I'm not sure we want that, right? I think that there are maybe other forms of cooperativism that we could strive for.
And I would also add to your point, Maeve, that Sam's kind of point is it's maybe not about the end goal, but the process.
Yeah, I think that's right. And that's a really nice way of thinking about it. And this is an ongoing process. No democracy is done. Ever.
Yeah, and it ties into our themes from last week about ends and means, collateral damage, might makes right. All the questions about if the process is the focus, then it steers us a little bit clear of some of those temptations. All right. Well, look, thank you both so much. Amanda, thank you for all these incredible insights.
Thank you for having me in the basement.
Wow. That's that sounds, we'll address the how that sounds in a minute. Maeve, thank you for being with us.
Thank you for letting me into your
basement. Yeah, it's hard to follow that innuendo.
I'm going to try to make it, I don't know, tamer. I don't know. Thanks for, I'm in my office, yeah. So that's where I am. Thank you for letting me join you from my office.
You're at a Bushwick dance party is where you're at.
I am definitely at a dance party. It's pretty exciting out there. If people can hear the music, and a little bit of part of me hopes you can, because you know.
It's spring in New York City, y'all.
It's rocking.
All right, Audio Avengers, that is our show for today. We have so much more to talk about on CharacterCast and PonderVision, so stay tuned for those for sure. And if you can, leave us a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts, especially if you're in Croatia, Sweden, New Zealand, or Ireland. Please definitely let us know what you think about the show, and thank you so much for listening. If you can tell a friend, that would mean a lot. Anything you can do to help us spread the word means the world to us. As the person who hosts, produces, edits, designs, markets the damn thing, I can assure you this is entirely a labor of love. So if you're loving it too, please let somebody know. Okay, team, let's get out there and try not to offend the Dora Milaje, shall we?